Hi, my name is Cliff Goodman. I'm a senior VP at the Lewin Group, a healthcare policy consulting firm located near Washington, D.C. Glad to be here. Since we just found out about the extraordinary financial and other types of burden posed by state Medicare programs, we'll stay in that general field and look at state employee health plans. When you consider the extraordinary pressures under which states must operate, this is another big chunk of it, state employees. And you know, historically, state employees in many, though not necessarily all states, have built up some pretty generous health benefits, retirement benefits, and as the baby boom does its thing, and the birth rate has done its thing, and other demographic factors are at work, this poses another extraordinary burden on states. And we're going to hear today about, I think, some brave people who are trying to innovate in that environment. And as you all know, everybody's got your bios here in your nifty little booklets. And first up to talk about innovations in state employee health plans is going to be Joan Kapowicz. She's the administrator of the Oregon Educators and Public Employees Benefit Boards. And she's going to be followed to my immediate right by Kevin Limbo, who's a state controller in Connecticut. They're on opposite ends of the country, but I think as you're going to find out, one of the things that they have in common is a willingness, actually not a willingness, a need, almost a mandate to innovate in this very, very difficult environment. So each of them is going to speak for somewhere between 10 and 12 minutes approximately, and then we're going to go to some discussion among the three of us, and then we'll open it up for questions, and we're going to take this to quarter past the hour. So Joan, you are up first.
Thank you.
And we're going to show some PowerPoint up here. There it is.
That's my big head.
Just been blinded by tumble from the stage. Thank you.
I'll be back.
Well, I don't know about brave. Maybe foolhardy might be one term used to describe my current capacity as the administrator of these boards. But here, I'm here to talk about value-based benefit design. And Oregon has been at this since 2006. Who are we in Oregon? We're the Public Employees Benefit Board, PEB, or the Oregon Educators Benefit Board for Educational Employees, OEB. And that's total 275,000 covered lives. These are management and labor boards, which as you just hear that combination, that means kind of a negotiation is assumed. And these are part of people's compensation package, right? So people take it very personally. From the beginning, these boards in statute have been directed to do a number of things as they design and administer benefit programs. And the thing that caught my eye when I was applying for this job was that creativity and innovation were part of it. And I could not think of a more appropriate thing in this arena. But before I go farther into our value-based design, I want to tell you about that's who we are. And I want to talk to you about who we are now, because we are healthier now. We have HEDIS measures that are in like the 90th percentile plus range for most all of them. We've been at value-based design for quite a while, and our carriers do a fine job with making sure we're getting the care that we need. And that's critically important. We also use a behavior risk factor survey. This is a public health survey, surveys people about what their health risks are. And we use that to determine what our health risks are, and then we change our benefit design to address that. So for example, we found out that about two-thirds of our employees, not different than the rest of the population, are overweight or obese. And 91% of them were interested in changing that, lowering it, or maintaining it. And so we put forward a value-based weight management program, Weight Watchers, it turned out, on-site, online, on the job, and 9 to 15% of all of our employees participated in it. This changed the culture in workplaces around the state because people worked with each other. They both formed teams. They went a-walking. They had healthy potlucks. And people who weren't participating were fearful of bringing in unhealthy food because they would get the stink eye, or they just felt like, hey, this is a good thing, right? So that wasn't what we expected, but we were thrilled when it happened. What we saw was a 21% decrease in the obesity rates of our populations 2 years after that program started. Tobacco cessation quit rates have been really well as well. About 4 years after PEB started their no-cost tobacco cessation program and no-cost or low-cost tobacco quit medications, we dropped 47% in terms of our tobacco use rate. People are eating more fruits and vegetables. Woohoo! And they feel good about their health. one of the best indicators of your future health is your current belief about your health status. So are you poor, fair, good, excellent? 4 years ago, 58% of PEB members said they were good or excellent, and it's now 68%. That's really sweet. And then the last thing that I skipped over, 30% reduction in missed days in the last 30 days. So bending the trend, this top line, the red line, is the medical trend. And since 2010, which is when we started, we went more fully self-insured, about 85% self-insured through 13 and 14 is where the little arrow ends. The top is medical trend, and many of you have seen that as well. And then this yellow line is our average or composite premium that we charge agencies. This is for our PEB program. So it went from 6.9% average, 5.7, and then the last 2 years, 5 and 5. Now, if we had been psychic, because you're estimating when you're doing self-insurance, right, like you are in terms of projecting costs, the line for 2012 instead of 5% would have been much lower because we came in a lot less than we expected in terms of our rates. And in 13, we're in the same spot. We're coming in much better. We're about 85% incurred loss ratio right now, much better than expected. And in 14, we're taking a pass on any rates, any premium increase at all. I don't know that it gets a whole lot better than that. So our benefit design, we have been at this for a really pretty long time now. 2006, we started with no cost for things like immunizations, mammograms, pap smears, those kinds of things. And then we started to look at behaviors. Okay, we want to address tobacco. Well, okay, no cost tobacco cessation. And then no cost weight management. And then no cost for chronic medications for chronic conditions. And then no cost for you to go to chronic care office visits. So these each built on things we were seeing in terms of behaviors that we wanted to change and influence. And then just most recently, we added in-network substance abuse treatment at no cost. Because we know these are underlying drivers of care. We also know that many people are not screened for their use of substance abuse, so we are paying through grants to train physicians around our state and clinicians to do ESPRT, which is Substance Abuse Brief Intervention Referral and Treatment, which is a mini assessment in an office visit. They will be paid for it, so we can engender more people being screened and directed to treatment if appropriate, or at least have them acknowledge that maybe you're drinking that 9 drinks a night is maybe high, you know, for an average drinker. And so, and in the future, it might not be causing you problems now. In the future, you're going to have problems. And what we know from ESPRT is that that drives people's utilization down. Medical homes, we've been at this a long time as well. We started in 2006, and we made the plan design a little sweeter if you went to a medical home. We do a lot of grants to encourage wellness around the state, whether it's helping school-based clinics or get a breast milk bank started in our state. But all these things affect the health of our whole populations. Our benefits evolved. So we started with the lowering the bar, so there's no reason you don't want to use that benefit, right? You gotta go. Last excuse is taken away from you. And then we said, okay, there's some things we don't want people to do. And that helps pay for that other side, right? So we then looked at, well, what would we pay less for? Okay, how about overutilized or preference sensitive? Things you might have a different option to do. So one of the biggest overutilization things in our state was sleep studies. High-tech imaging, upper endoscopies, those were way high in the utilization arena. And then things like spinal surgeries, hip and knee replacements, my apologies to the orthopedist from the previous panel, but they were up there, arthroscopies, and then we added later gastric bypass, and most recently we added viscosupplementation for the knee. So we use evidence to show which of these procedures might be on it, and if it's on the expensive end, you pay an additional $500 in addition to your regular cost sharing, not subject to out-of-pocket or deductible. And if it's a lesser cost service like imaging, you pay $100 extra. Medical homes. Not only do we pay the clinicians a little extra to be a medical home provider on a per-head basis, but we also said if you don't go to a medical home in terms of our plan design medical home, but if you go to our statewide plan and your physician clinician is a medical home, because our Oregon Health Authority now has 3 tiers for medical home, you would get a lower cost for your primary care services received in that medical home. So suddenly patients were calling and saying, hey doc, are you a medical home? And if they said no, they'd say, why not? Because that helps me. So they had a real uptick in clinicians suddenly being interested in being a medical home, which is great. So that brought us to the 75% plus we have of members enrolled in medical homes today. in the PEB side, and our teacher side, about 64% and growing. We have pay for performance, we use reference pricing, many of the things you heard about on the first panel we have been working with as well. And we use a lot of contract language to encourage the kind of things we want to see, whether it's early inductions of labor, use of surgical checklists, and the like. It's a way to push progress, and for us, pushing it across all lines to the degree we can. So bending the trend, what did the additional cost tier do? Well, first off, I will say that we're hoping that Massachusetts Institute of Technology and University of Penn are looking to study this formally. But this is an informal assessment. This means this is our 15 to 30% reductions in sleep studies, upper endoscopy, and high-tech imaging. And those have stayed down. In terms of the musculoskeletal kind of procedures, between 5 and 17% decreases and then moderation, which is pretty unheard of in those particular areas. The trends have decreased, as you saw in that earlier slide. The premiums are down in terms of moderating the increases, so we're feeling pretty good about that trend. So now I want to talk about something I call our value-based benefit design for health engagement, or now I'm kind of calling it designing for health, because that's really what the value would be, right? Getting us healthy, keeping us healthy. So PEB in 2012 introduced something called the Health Engagement Model, or HEM as the term was used. It was, other terms were bandied about it because it wasn't terribly popular. But in the first year, we got 85% of our members that said they would do it because we were going to penalize them financially if they didn't, $17.50 a month. In the end, we said you had to do a health assessment online and a spouse partner on our plan, and you had to do 2 e-lessons. If you were a tobacco user or you had a weight issue, you had to address those 2 issues. You didn't have to lose weight, you didn't have to quit smoking, but you had to take action. We didn't do biometrics because that was very expensive, so we came up with some proxies. A few questions were mandatory, and one of the proxy questions was your waist circumference. That was not too popular. As one member wrote me in big capital letters, "Keep your hands off my love handles." It's a deal. So we moved past this. We're still dealing with a few lawsuits about it. But we modified the program. The next year, we decided we would pay people $17.50 a month if they did it. And 77% of people decided to do it with their spouse partner. So they had to do the health assessment at the beginning to get in and be eligible. And then they do two actions that they can choose to do. And some of them can be going to the dentist, your mammogram. But many of them, we say, address your issue, you know, exercise more, do, you know, whatever your risks are shown to be, and that will count. This year, we're doing open enrollment right now, and to date, 88% of people said they would do it. Now, I don't know that they'll all complete their health assessment, but when I saw the figure 88%, I figured, woohoo, that's really good. So we're very happy about it. One of our angry members wrote to the letter to the editor, what will PEB have us doing next? Next, they'll be telling us we have to marry monkeys to stay employed and have insurance. I read that at breakfast one morning, and I had to chuckle because we hadn't thought of that. but maybe there's a way. It could be used as a motivator. So people get flipped out. I mean, this is really personable to a lot of people. This is real private. This is socialist, as many told me. And illegal, which it hasn't yet been found to be. But you can sense from this kind of reaction, not in the love handles, you get a lot of emotion in this. And in many ways, that's actually a good thing. So right now, we rolled one out for the educators, because the educators did this 2 years later after they saw the hubbub over this. And it's been much smoother, much more positive, because so many employers are doing this now. It's almost like you can't find somebody who isn't doing this. It's more the norm. We actually have people calling and saying, I'd like to do a salsa dancing class in coordination with my local symphony. Would that count as a health action? You bet. That's a great idea. So it's good ideas and health we want to engender, but it has a lot of hinkiness for some people still. So what's the role of health insurers here or employers? I mean, are they going to be behind the counter when you're doing the grocery and they're going to say, marshmallow cream, no, but no bacon, put that back. We're not quite that invasive. But for some people, it feels that way. So we need to have that caution in how we roll this out, how people take it, because we want it to change behavior. It's a benefit design, but we want it to change behavior. And so we have to be sensitive to how we do that. So as we looked forward in what we want to do to influence our behavior, we tried to look at as many ideas as possible. So we're doing things like we're offering at no cost, value-based design, the diabetes prevention program. What a concept. We will pay at no cost something to help you prevent diabetes, not just pay for it after the fact. We're paying for the Stanford Better Living with Chronic Conditions program at no cost to you. We're doing a pilot on cognitive behavioral therapy with Kaiser online because many of our people won't go to see a counselor face-to-face. So we're looking at a number of things. We're also doing a gym subsidy because 80% of our members are sedentary most of the day. So we're trying to do things that are positive, that are appealing to people. This one program, which I really would love to be able to show you the video, and maybe if there's a way in time we can. It's about 4 minutes. This is a program called Healthy Team, Healthy You that's been studied for many years in our state, how to promote healthy behavior in small populations. They've studied it in firefighters, in employee groups, and it's team-based. It's evidence-proven that when you work with coworkers on goals and on health classes, this is over a period of 12 weeks, half hour a week, you don't have to do any work. It's a little handbook. You can get it on your iPad or on paper, and people are healthier as a result. People work together as teams, and they're stronger. So you have to leverage this benefit design, this behavior change, with real people who have real emotion and care about each other, and that's how you start leveraging. That was the success of the Weight Watcher model, and that's what really is going to drive, I think, in a positive way, the kind of models we want to see in value-based design. It's not enough just to change the benefit design. You have to change the underlying behavior. I think we're all owners in this process. We all have a piece in this. And if we can get people to care and be as emotional in a positive way as the person who didn't want us to touch their love handles, and we hear from these people now, thank you for him. I was your harshest critic, and I went to the doctor and I found a tumor, but I think I'm going to be okay. We get story after story of success of people working in teams, and that gets the behavior change out there. I think you can do it with Medicaid population, senior population, you can do it with our population. This, to me, is really a key element. Grasping that emotional component, the team component for support, because that's how we stay stronger together. We don't have enough money to buy health. God knows we haven't been successful to date. These are pretty inexpensive programs, most of these self-management programs. So we have to move from this external rewards. I really am embarrassed that we're paying people to do these things, but for the moment, that's what we need to do. But I think ultimately many people would be more than happy to participate in something that helped them feel good, connect with their coworkers, and enjoy life, truly enjoy life, and have a zest for it that they haven't had for many years if they've been in ill health. Success is contagious. We strongly encourage you to share any successes you have. Make the most of them, because we all should. Because together, you, me, we, us, really have to do this. Design for health. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you, Joan. That's great. Well, as Kevin's coming up, Joan, we could kind of set you up for a question later on. Mm-hmm. This is a great explanation of behavior change and so forth. One thing we're going to wonder about is how do you sort of, come on in, John. How do you sort of cope with you making a lot of changes quickly and trying out a lot of things? Do you have the sort of administrative and logistical sort of elbow room to do this so quickly? We don't think of state governments as being fast on their feet, so maybe that's something you could address later.
Sure.
Okay?
Sure.
Kevin, you're on.
Yeah. Great. I'm going to stay in Joan's spot because it seemed to work. So thank you. It's great to be here, Mark, wherever you are. Thank you for the invitation to the sponsors of the conference, to Chris Kohler and the folks at Milbank. I appreciate their assistance as well. My political staff back at the office, I was supposed to come last year about the storms and all of that stuff. And then this year they came to me and said, you know, you might not want to go because Michigan over UConn football 24-21, I'm just saying. We're still smarting about it, and Wolverine seems to me to be a rather mean and unpredictable animal. So just to build a box around the comptroller's office and the role, so we have a bunch of constitutional officers in Connecticut. And I am one of those. We're elected every 4 years on the governor's cycle. And I'm in charge of things like, in addition to state employee health care purchasing, retirement administration, and paying the state's bills, and administering the payroll. And then this other job called the fiscal guardian, where I get to stand up and call the balls and strikes on the budget and say, yeah, you budgeted X. It's actually X plus, and we got to do something about that. So it's not always a happy place to be. I love it, but other people aren't always happy to see me coming. So the state is small, as you know, and our budget's about $20 billion, the general fund budget, and we're about 5,500 square miles, so we should be able to figure it out, if we can figure it out anywhere. So in 2010, the constitutional officers were all elected and walked in the door to a $3.8 billion projected budget deficit. I want to, at this point, acknowledge Bob Krish. Attorney Krish is in the back of the room from Connecticut. And Bob, in addition to the other hats that he wears, is actually a very gifted labor lawyer, but also one of the guys who put the health enhancement program that I'm going to talk to you about on the map, on the conference table, in front of the governor and his administration. This was a labor-generated and initially labor-driven initiative. So when you go back home and you hear, we can't do this, we've got SEIU and AFSCME and 11-9. We have all those unions, and they're happy to talk to your folks at home. So these guys all went behind the curtain. The comptroller doesn't go back behind the curtain with them, and they came out with this health enhancement program in an effort to wrangle some of our state employee health care costs. And there wasn't a lot of talk about the challenges of privacy and medical decisions, but pretty quickly that came flying forward when the state employee unions voted down the agreement the first time, saying things like, damn that Dan Malloy, our governor, he wants me to have a colonoscopy, how dare he? So, you know, we had to sort of back them up and talk a little bit and concede a little bit, and then we got to a deal. I'd like to say, again, the inventors of the program looked to Joan, and they looked to Pitney Bowes, and they looked to other folks who were doing this kind of work in this space and took some learning from that and brought it to the table. I think all of us would agree if we could go into a room today, we might design it slightly differently, but it is what it is, and hopefully, well, I'll show you. I think it's working. But it started out under two basic commitments, and one of those was that we wanted our folks to get primary care because we've been banging the drum on primary care all these years, and we knew on the data and we knew on the experience that it was the right place and a medical home and all those things mattered. And then we looked at the numbers on what we were spending money on and realized there were five disease states slash conditions that were driving the rest of our spend, and we needed to do something to try to wrangle those numbers. Now, I was the state healthcare advocate before I was elected comptroller, and my job was to bang insurance companies every day for denying care and making bad decisions. So now that I am a insurer type, I sit with all the same data, and well, I should say that I apologize, but I don't. So the program, you know, waived some copays for preventive visits, as it says here, reducing monthly premium share and waiving annual deductibles. What the parties did when they went behind the curtain is decided they were going to develop a new program for state employees, and it had $100 more in premium every month and a $350 deductible up to $1,400 for a family and some other things tied to it. But the way you could get out from under all of those changes was to opt in to the health enhancement program. So it was a choice. The governor's budget office, when they were trying to figure out how to put a number on this, thought it would be about 50% uptake because most folks were not going to be bothered with this $100 or care about the deductible, and that they were going to get a whole bunch of immediate infusion of cash into the budget, remember $3.8 billion. To try to offset some of that. And as it turns out, in the first go-around, 98% of employees opted in. Again, not because they were enthused about health enhancement, but because they wanted to avoid the $100. And we'll get to some compliance numbers in a minute. We had to set it up not as a separate plan, because these folks, based on their compliance, have the potential to get punted out of the program if they're not complying. And so it's not a plan by itself. It's an option, and it bolts on to all of the existing other offerings that we have in our plan. And we did a special enrollment, and we really did the outreach. We spoke to state employees. All of our unions spoke to their members. And once they got past the vote And as those wounds from the negotiation were starting to heal over, they were able to start to talk to folks about the value of this and why it matters. Annual compliance evaluation. The staff in my office looks at sort of who did what they were supposed to do or not. And ultimately, we take the final list after multiple attempts at intervention to get folks to get right with the program, take it to something we call the Healthcare Cost Containment Committee, which is the labor management body in Connecticut. It's also important to remember or to know that in Connecticut, everything is bargained, including my tie. No, but a lot is bargained. So, you know, not only the actuarial value of the plan, but all the way down. And the Healthcare Cost Containment Committee meets on a monthly basis, and they want to know everything about everything that we're doing down to the language of the letter. So just for background, it's not like these were a hands-off group of people to begin with. So again, five chronic disease conditions or states. Asthma, I'll just set aside for a second because the incidence was mostly among the minor dependent population, and we set that aside when we came out of the box because it was a little hard to get to the kids. COPD, diabetes, hypertension, and high cholesterol. Those lower copays, you can see there's some zeros on the meds for some of these drugs. We wanted to take down, as Joan said earlier, any barriers that we could find and sort of knock those down, any excuse at all to get folks to see their doc and take their meds, waiving the copays on visits to doctors who are treating them for these illnesses as well. We first started out using, we have Anthem Blue Cross and Blue Shield, which is a WellPoint affiliate, and United Healthcare as our two TPAs in the state employee plan on the health side. They have a wellness, a disease management program that we had heard a lot about. We were told that it was being used with our members back when we were fully insured, and I'm sure anybody who buys insurance from a carrier now hears that they've got this program. We found out pretty quickly that the program wasn't much to it, and there wasn't a lot of touches, and there wasn't a lot of meaningful outreach on the part of the plan. So we went out in year two put out an RFP for a new vendor to do that work, and so far, so good. For the chronically ill population at the end of the year, if you are in fact compliant, there's another $100 kicker, $66-some-odd after taxes, another $100 kicker at the end. So compliance numbers. So I said there was about a 98% uptake in the first year. And I'm going to say we had a soft compliance requirement in the first year. And what I mean by that was there were issues getting to primary care providers. There was issues getting appointments. There were all these sort of infrastructure issues that were impeding our members' ability to satisfy their requirements in the program. And also, you know, look, we didn't want them out in that 50% who were not participating in the program. We wanted them in. So we wanted them to feel successful. So within reasonable limits, folks were pretty successful. Year two, which we just completed recently, 99% of the employees were in, and 99% were compliant. And we ratcheted up the compliance standard and held them to a higher standard, more directly related to what the parties had bargained. So the folks who are not right with the program get an opportunity to get right with it, and once they do that, they can come back in. There was some disagreement on whether they should be held out for a year and allowed to come back in, but it is what it is. About 127,000 covered lives in those compliant households. This one I'm going to skip over because I found a big hole in it last night at 11 o'clock and couldn't correct it in time, so I'm going to move on. You can see we're going to correct it before you post it. Chronic disease medication adherence, I know I'm not supposed to call it compliance. You can see sort of what the industry standard in it is as communicated to us by our carriers and by Milliman, who does our analysis, and the most recent 12 months in yellow, and then the prehab numbers. So, you know, things are moving in the right direction. A lot of reasons, as we all know, why folks don't want to take their cardiac meds, especially those for COPD. Now, here's last time we were together, some of us were together, I was talking about ER visits are down. ER visits are sort of down, and I think there's a number of reasons why that's so. So the top line is the Medicare retirees who are not part of HEP at that point, at this point, for a number of reasons, up to and including what you heard in the first panel about the issues in working together with Medicare. Pre-Medicare retirees are the lighter blue, and the yellow are our active employees. So our active employees, most of whom are in HEP, their ED utilization is on the way down, and you could argue that our non-Medicare retirees are flat, slightly up, but we need to bend that down. I need to do something about that upper number, and there's lots of things. We've got boutique ERs, and we've got all kinds of things going on in Connecticut, and I'm sure you've got them going on in other places that are hurting the heck out of us. Being the numbers guy, dollar guy, pre-hep 8.9 medical trend on our active employees, and now 2.2. So something's working. I don't want to hang it all on HEP. HEP certainly had a big piece of it. We've negotiated new contracts on pharmacy, squeezed them a little bit, and got some savings there. So there's a lot of moving parts. Medical home is also a big piece of this as well. We're expanding out to the municipal market. Legislature allowed us to sell product to have municipalities and boards of ed come into coalition for purposes of buying insurance through us. Those plans have the health enhancement program embedded into it. There's only about 2,800 lives in there now, but stay tuned. A couple of our bigger cities are coming in. I mentioned medical home. More work, as had been mentioned earlier, I think in this case, the state is sort of leaning in on ACOs and some of those kinds of things, and we're hearing from our carriers the same thing. Thank you for doing that, because now we feel like we have the freedom to do it. We need to do more about the ED and employee education, and it's helpful to be a couple of years behind Joan, because I can sort of steal all her stuff and do that in Connecticut. So lessons learned, and I'll wrap. I just want to make sure I have my list, because there's so many lessons learned to be learned. One of the things that was negotiated was twice a year dental visits, cleanings. I don't know why two was picked, and Bob could probably tell us how the storyline went, there seems to be little evidence for a healthy population to mandate two cleanings. It drove up. We're fully insured for dental care. Not quite sure why that is so, but we need to figure that out. We held folks on compliance to one visit in the first year. We're paying for two. University of Michigan Center for Oral Health Research lives somewhere in these walls. Just came out with a great June of 2003 saying, yeah, you don't need to have two unless you've got a couple of chronic disease states. Mental health, we need to wrap our arms around it. We've got about a $50 million spend all in. But that's the one I'm most concerned about. I'm more concerned about the undiagnosed stuff that's impacting the health, and I'm out of time. Thank you.
Good. Thank you very much. John, could you sit over here?
Sure.
Grab my water.
Okay. One thing you might have learned from listening to both speakers is that learning is going on. So Keith freely admits that he steals from Joan. He also likes Pitney Bowes. So this is actually not a trivial point. With all this experimentation going on in the states and their fast failures and some big winners, they're carried on. We're all looking over each other's shoulders as this is proceeding. So Joan, just if we could go back to that question I kind of teed up before, how do you get such, it appears that you're trying out a bunch of things and that you've got some leeway to operate. Is that really the case in the state government?
Well, the benefit boards, by statute, were directed to, hey, go forth and do good. And when I got there in 2007, they had started the tobacco cessation, and that's when, we were getting questions from members, because we had free tobacco cessation, but the medications weren't free. And so members were calling in complaining that, hey, you want me to do this, but I need medication, and I don't want to pay for it, basically. So I called the carriers at that point and just said, give it up, because they were putting bigger dot, like on Chantix and some of those. Anyway, so part of this is nudging. In this case, we were fully insured with one of the carriers and saying, you really should do this. This makes sense.
But a phone call from you
phone
pulls
call
it
from
off?
In that case. Now, but then you bring it back to the board if you want to do bigger benefit changes. Because in that case, the carrier's at risk, right? So if you can convince them and it's a lowering the bar, you didn't have to ask the board permission to do that, okay? But if you're going to make other changes, and so when we were looking at after, well, tobacco cessation went well, so what are our next risks? We're lucky we're one of the few states that uses a behavior risk factor surveillance survey that public health uses, so we knew where our risks were, and we knew what we wanted to address. And you can't avoid the obesity, overweight, and so the trick was designing something that would actually work, and so we looked for evidence-based, availability, and then kind of jumped in to do that, and it was almost so popular it just about killed us because people weren't doing it. So we have been, I would say, on the bleeding edge more than the fun edge a good part of this time, because Weight Watchers didn't even know how to do it. They didn't have enough leaders. We had phone calls on like the 3rd of January. Where's the meeting in my building? Well, we don't have one yet, because you need to have a certain number of people, you know, all those kind of, the admin piece, as the earlier group mentioned, well, is enough to need a support group for. So all these things were good. They were very popular, though, that particular one, very popular. So when the board gets feedback, it's good, it's popular, it's helping. It's easier to make changes going forward. I would say the substance abuse one is the one I probably have gotten them, other than HEM, which is a different story. Substance abuse, I got a fair amount of pushback on, even though everybody admits substance abuse is a problem. There's a lot of ethical, sort of moral things still associated with it. So people, both boards, they said, is it a problem for us? Yes, it's a problem for us. How do we get doing? And then, you know, they're on board with it. It's if you can show the evidence is there. Our boards have been very willing to take some risk and say the evidence points to it. Population health will be improved. We believe it's important to do this.
So your boards play with you once you've shown successes.
I think, and once we can say there's evidence that we should, you know, we really, this is an effective way to do it. In the case of weight management, there isn't terribly good evidence. But the issue was, it's a problem, we need to do something, and doing nothing isn't acceptable. And in the end, we learned the lesson that the culture change was as dramatic as what we later found out was the true decreases in overweight and obesity.
Wow. But, so in a minute, we're going to, if folks have questions, we'll have mics walking around in a few minutes, so you may want to tee up your questions. Keith, you made the very important point that Connecticut is a real high negotiation state, to put it that way. What is counterintuitive sometimes to a third-party observer is that it's not always clear that employees' unions are bargaining in favor of their own health and welfare. It sometimes seems that they're bargaining in ways that they're doing you a favor if you're providing them something that's going to improve their health. Does that come up in these negotiations?
Well, I mean, I think the opposite has been true. I mean,
in Connecticut.
I mean, folks have worked hard to not only maintain, to hang on to a benefit, a valued benefit for their members, but to restructure in a way that it is both more effective and sustainable over time. And that argument around sustainability of the benefit and the financing mechanisms and all that seems to have taken hold, and folks understand now that this is not only good for me, it's good for my family, it's good for the program, and it's good for the financial health of the program going forward, and I guess therefore the state.
But that, this
so,
is what puzzles
I mean, I don't want to sort of paint too broadly with that, but that's the narrative.
You have kind of acknowledged the importance of sort of a collaborative effort and so forth. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the stuff that Joan has kind of taken away, the upper endoscopies, the visco supplementation, things like that, are the unions willing to give that stuff up? It seems like those are bargaining chips.
I don't know the answer to that at this point. I feel like we are getting a couple of years of experience under our belt on what we're already doing, and we'll see where we are. But like anyone else, when I look at the data out on the table and I look at the outliers on, you know, outcomes, you know, it is clear to me that in some cases it is cheaper for me to put a state employee in a town car and drive them across the state and their family probably back and forth daily to visit them to get that knee or that hip done elsewhere rather than in their home community. Now, can we get to, I wouldn't propose that because, well, for lots of reasons, but, it, you know, how do we then sort of point that out as a huge problem around cost and quality and lay that out for our members in a way that helps them to make better decisions? That feels to me like the next piece of it. It is continuing to collect what we've got.
Right.
And then educating our members on, you know, I don't want to say centers of excellence because that seems to be a brand at this point, but where they can have great outcomes and maybe the state can do it at a better price.
So when you do get to a negotiating table then, literally or figuratively, are you negotiating on the same side? Are both sides basically in favor of greater employee outcomes? Same metrics even?
I think for the administration side, you know, we sit as almost a third party at the table. The comptroller does.
Yeah.
So the governor appoints the management negotiators and labor appoints theirs. Do I think this is mostly financially driven on the management side? Sure. Do I think it's probably more about wellness and then sustainability in that order for the labor side? Sure. But, you know, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Joan, you have some very interesting aspects about behavior change. One of them, it's almost microeconomics. Is it better to have to not pay $100 or to get paid $100 to induce behavior change? There's a lot of behavioral change, sort of microeconomic learnings about that. What have you come across there that might be useful for other people in sort of inducing behavior change financially or otherwise?
Well, our consultants, when we were putting this together, and we had a subcommittee of the board that to focus on HEM and to design it a little bit, and they said, if you have a negative, you know, someone's going to have a loss, you're going to get more people to participate. And so that was the advice we went forward on. This is how we're going to organize HEM, because we said there's all these ways you could do it. If you do a negative, more people will participate. So the board, the subcommittee agreed to that. The board agreed to that. Then we had about 5 months where the board didn't want to announce exactly what they were doing because they were negotiating labor contracts, which included for the first time in many, many, many years, a premium share of 5%. Mm. Not too bad, but 5%, with a deductible of $250. So it was really unpopular when they finally did negotiate that and allow, and then announce the HEM that was going to be a negative. I mean, we heard a lot of screaming because people hadn't had this before. This was all new. So we said negative, and then with all the brouhaha, that's when the board decided to change it for the following year. But I think the negative did help us get to a high number. Right. And then when we went to the lower number, several board members said, well, see, we still did pretty well. And I said, this isn't like a study where you can just keep changing. I do it this way, I do it this way. You can't really tell what the mechanisms were, right? But I think with more groups doing this, with more of an acknowledgement mm-hmm. that even if you have a negative or a positive on the other end, that it isn't really that tough to do this and you have good things to participate in, most people understand why you want them to do it.
What then, for each of you, what then sort of comprised the tipping point? Both of you described, I just wrote some astounding numbers, successes, and successes early, by the way, first-year successes. So what if anything, surprised you the most about those successes early on? Or were you expecting those all the way?
No. I'd like to say yes, because then it would make me sound like just brilliant. The adoption rate, surprise. The willingness to engage, a bit of a surprise. I thought for sure the noncompliance number was going to be out of control because I believed, and I still think it's true, that, as I said, folks got in to avoid the higher cost share. But in year two, you know, they're maintaining that level, and we're handing out those $100 bonuses to our chronically ill population. So, you know, we painted it as a positive on the front end. Avoid the pain, come on in. Mm-hmm. There's the compliance piece, which has a thread of negative if you don't get right, and then there's that other little $100 kicker at the other end. So it's sort of a blended, you know, hug me, go away kind of strategy.
Joan, what surprised you about it?
Well, there were a lot of surprises. But I think the fact that we said, doing your health assessment, you only have to do 4 questions, I think is what it was in the end. I mean, one of which was waist circumference as a proxy. In the end, 95% of people answered every single question. So, in fact, people were getting the information for themselves. We also did a follow-up study about the health, the e-lessons, which were the other modules, because we heard a lot of calls. I had people calling me, telling me these were the stupidest things they'd ever had to be done in their life and what idiots we were. But in the research of our members, they actually, 50% of them that did the e-lessons, of the 50% that did them, 94% of them changed their behavior as a result of the e-lessons. I mean, there's a pretty simple, accessible, and I had one gal at public health, who's, you know, she's a public health expert, and their public health ragged me a lot on this, because we didn't do things the classic way, but whatever. And she said, you know, and I took that sleep one, because I have sleep problems, and I'm waiting for the how stupid it was thing, and she said, you know, it actually worked. So, again, sometimes it's almost disarming that sometimes it is the simple things that work, and sometimes it doesn't have to be super complicated. Mm-hmm. And in this case, I know there's a whole traditional way to do wellness, and you have the leaders at the top lead the way and be the champions, and, you know, we aren't getting that. I mean, that's not easily done. Mm-hmm. So in this case, we put something in on the ground level, pretty, you know, democratic, as it were, and people actually take it up, and I think I think the influence has gone more from this level up than the top.
So it's more peer influence once you kind of kick the thing off?
Peer influence is the key here. If we can tap peer influence, we got a good thing going.
Because you talked about the co-worker teams, which sound to be very successful, and then you said this business about everyone is an owner and the internal reward thing happened. So it's not so much, once you sort of kick it off with $100 gain or loss, whichever it is, once they get started, their internal rewards and peer rewards. Is that it?
Yeah, I mean, they'll talk to anybody about it. I mean, you know, it's like anybody, you know, lost weight here, quit smoking. I mean, you'll talk to anybody about it. You'll remember this your whole life. These are really positive events that people feel connected with other people about. And that is, I think, the real magic of making this value-based and helping people get into it.
Excellent. Questions from the floor thus far? We've got one right in the middle of the room here. Row 6, seat 6. In the middle. Keep trying.
Okay.
Good.
So quick question. I mean, you know, it seems like part of the... Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Martin Zagari. I work for Amgen. Thanks, and I'm in the health economics department there. It seems like for both plans, a big part of the success in terms of keeping costs, you know, on a straightened level or getting them to decrease was the excluded or higher cost services. So, Joan, you made them most clear. Yeah, you know, orthopedic procedures, you know, high-tech imagery, spine surgery, those sorts of things. You made a casual reference to the board sort of looking at the evidence and deciding on those. And I assume that there were similar discussions, Kevin, in Connecticut. No?
No, but we haven't excluded anything.
So maybe my question is more for Joan. Could you give us more insight into the depth of that conversation, where the evidence sort of came from, you know, how those specifically were chosen, and then maybe some insight onto where you would go from there, particularly around some of the emerging, choosing wisely types initiatives.
Great question.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to stand because you're going to see my feet dangle soon. I'm going to feel foolish. Okay. First, we had two options. The Oregon uses a prioritized list of services that a health services commission, now called Health Evidence Review Commission, has been working for years to more valued services in terms of health outcomes. The top, less valued at the bottom. So they had designed a prototype for commercial that wasn't really very far along at the time our boards were looking at it. So that was one way to do it. Another group came forward with using basically the Dartmouth Atlas. These were insurers that wanted to do sort of a value-based design and said, here's the Dartmouth Atlas list. You'd put these services over here and you'd say, and this includes things like cardiac bypass, hysterectomy, spinal, whatever. You'd put them on a separate deductible, separate out-of-pocket, like 50% cost share. So those were our two prototypes that we could choose from. We picked something in the middle, much lower barrier, but based on, you know, the Dartmouth Atlas. And then we added to that our own overutilized services, which were things like sleep studies, okay? Then when in early 2011, we had some financial, it was looking like our finances weren't doing too good in the PEB plan. So they said, you know, bring us a list of other things we could, you know, think about in terms of putting it on the additional cost tier. So we looked to the Oregon prioritized list of services, and we put a whole list together. And this was things like bunionectomies, hammer toe, neuroma, you know, pretty long list. And I brought it to the board thinking they're going to put a whole bunch more things on the additional cost tier. And what they did in the end was said, you know, this would be too confusing to explain. Let's just put those on excluded instead. Wow. So actually, one of the things I didn't say is this most recent go-around, and starting in January next year, they actually put back some things from being excluded to on the additional cost tier. Hammer toe, bunionectomy, neuroma, because those not having access to those impeded people's ability to be more functional in terms of exercising, which was one of the things we're wanting to promote.
Joan, why didn't you get sort of attacked by the spinal surgeons and the people that make those gizmos that they put in people's backs and the sleep people? I have to tell you, I've dealt with about 2/3 of these groups. They pipe up when you take away their toys.
Well, I'll tell you, I was sort of waiting to hear from more of them. And I did get a call one day from a local orthopedic group that they wanted to see me. So I went over, expecting to see the orthopedist, but in fact I was seeing the office manager. It was a very nice gentleman. And there was an office manager from another large orthopedic group in the state. And so they were sort of charged to go grill me about how I was being we were being unfair to orthopedists. And so I kind of went through what we're doing, what the board, how they chose these, blah, blah. And then I said, you know, we think plenty of people will still have the surgery. And they should. You know, there's the indications for it. But we're just putting a little extra bar here and because we want people to know all their alternatives. We want, you know, physical therapy and maybe a little weight loss. Maybe you could delay it. And, you know, and a lot of, you know, obesity or whatever. And one of the gentlemen said to me, well, we already do all that, and you know, we don't operate on certain people who are too overweight or whatever. And the other gentleman, not missing a beat, said, we don't. They pretty much cut on anybody. One group in the different part of the state actually put a nice little flyer, actually very nicely describing our entire program. He should have written it for us. I mean, you know, it was like could have been our marketing tool, because it very objectively described what we were doing, and they put it in a packet for every new orthopedic patient with a phone number to call me and one of our carrier's phone numbers. Neither of us got a call. Just goes to show you they don't read the stuff we hand them. But so I really didn't get any pushback at all. And we got one phone call on the warts from a dermatologist. And it was just, did you do this? Yes. That was it. We did hear from patients, you know, this is unfair, but, you know, it wasn't so high a bar they couldn't actually access it. So.
Wow. Okay. Sure, shout it out.
So it sounds like a bit of a yes, no, or I'm sorry, a little bit of a more of an impediment for those services. Were there any services where you kind of dug down a little deeper and said, well, in these instances, this service is appropriate, and in these instances...
Thank you for mentioning that. If it's cancer-related, it's not included here. If it's trauma-related, not included. We had the conversation that we're talking about, and pretty much everybody agreed that once you put that but for in there, there's going to be a way that you can write the but for, and you're really not going to have a program anymore.
Good, thanks.
So. Trauma and cancer.
Keith, are you going to go, Kevin,
that's excuse right.
me, Kevin, are you going to go down that road now?
I don't know the answer to that, but I'm sitting here listening, and I feel my healthcare advocate hat sort of slipping on, and you know, we rely pretty heavily on sort of the medical necessity determinations of the TPAs that we hire. We tweak them from time to time about it. I don't know if we would get to a point, but we were comparing spends just before this segment started.
Yeah.
And, you know, our spends are very similar. We're in a, but...
But it seems that the...
There's going to have to be a discussion about some of these things. And the low-hanging fruit is very obvious. But I'm sort of focused now on variance in price for the same thing and sort of regional differences and quality changes. And I'm thinking that my next pass is there. Versus sort of running the list of what's covered and what's not and excluded. Because it would have to be bargained, and I don't know that we would get through
it. She's been very successful with it, though.
Can I ask one other point I was going to make? Is the one other thing that we have talked about is if we could tie the shared decision support modules to sort of a payment mechanism. You know, like if you went through a decision support module, you would get a lower cost share. You know, so your additional cost here would drop. It's just that that's fairly hard to arrange. So one of our carriers is using the shared decision support modules for procedures like this in primary care. So they write you what they call an InfoRx prescription. When you want to, say, talk about a back surgery with your primary care, you go home, you click on the website, you see this whole shared decision support module, you go back to your primary care, and you have a conversation about it. And then you're very informed about the pros and cons, risks and harms. And that if we could make that easier, that would really help a lot of people at the primary care end, not when you're in the orthopedist office, but at the earlier in the process, so you know the risks and harms. Yeah. And to your point, I think there is variability in price, and we're working on a package pricing for hips and knees. But to me, the issue ultimately is I could get a better price probably. I mean, there's ways you can do that. But ultimately, for a lot of people, is they really don't understand they might be able to avoid a major surgery altogether. Mm-hmm. It's not for all of them, but if you could save a number of people from a major surgery in a relatively straightforward way, and in our case we found that many people will do more research if they have a higher financial stake, we think that's a patient safety kind of.
And I like that informed consent
versus
just.
Yeah, just no. Yeah.
We'll take a couple more brief questions first here, then. Microphone.
I don't need a mic.
I actually do, for me. Oh, just for me.
Paul Yeast, Cromwell Kaltara Institute. Many of us have been schooled about the real cost driver is technology by people in this room, and Hirth and Cherno, who's not here, I don't think. Have you had to confront the scenario of something new and where you stand on letting it be adopted?
Radiology? Image? I'm sorry.
Anything
new. Anything?
Any kind of new technology, do you have to perhaps get in the way?
Not so far, but not so far.
Joe.
Yeah, I would say the same. I mean, many of the things that come out, and if they're sort of standard practice, you know, we'll, but like on gastric bypass, we didn't cover that right off because mm-hmm. the previous school districts didn't. We don't cover things like in vitro. You know, so some things, the carriers themselves are the ones we say, you're responsible for looking at this new fancy and whatever and determining whether or not it's completely medically appropriate if there's other alternatives to it. So we really rely on them to help us be somewhat cautionary about use of it. If it's appropriate and it's if it's expensive and it has, you know, good outcomes, great, but there's many times it doesn't yet have that, and so sometimes that's will be where the pause factor is. Because these boards are mostly lay people, and you know, you don't really want them chiming in on it too often.
I think the specialty drugs are probably one that we're all
right,
watching,
right? Yeah,
the specialty
right.
drugs, the compounded, you know, these are sort of not only running into the market heavy, but they're also coming with other clinical sort of attachments to them around administration.
Right.
And, you know, they may in fact be the right thing. And to your point.
And we expect our care. So we ask our carriers every year, what are you doing in the area of specialty? How do you determine if with this specialty drug versus some alternative? And we do ask every year about what are you doing about keeping up with choosing wisely and how are you disseminating it? And mm-hmm. so those are pieces that are built into, that's an expectation of you.
Especially pharma rising faster than anything, and now accounts for almost all the top 10 or 20 drugs.
Yeah.
Payment. Well, last question from the floor. Yes. And the mic is not working. Oh, we thought you were going to do that. Okay.
Hi, my name is Kristen Manzolillo, and I'm with Pfizer. I had a question for the panel. First, thank you for your presentations. About the Cadillac tax, I think we keep reading and hearing a lot about the Cadillac tax, and I'm wondering what you're thinking about in terms of maybe value-based insurance design or other tactics. Has this entered your discussion as a means to maybe get the price of your plans below certain thresholds?
Cadillac tax for drugs.
A lot of running around hair on fire on the Cadillac tax. 2018, not sure how it's going to be defined. There's a lot about this that still is yet to be determined. And then sort of will we bump into it initially? Based on what I'm hearing so far, probably not. Will we bump into it because of the way it's going to move forward and the way our spend goes? Maybe. But it's not on the short list right now for us.
Joan?
On one of our boards, they have been talking about it, and they made it that every plan had to be offered. We have like 11 plan choices for the educational board, one of which was high deductible, but not all the groups picked it. So now almost all of them have it in their offering, and we do see more people moving to it. And we do have all the value-based design pieces we can get in it, we will. There's some prohibitions. But things like the Weight Watchers is in it, but I think it was substance abuse that you really couldn't quite do that. So we are watching it, and on the PEB side, we are going to have to start having that conversation. And I predict the hair on fire because it's just been not really popular in the past for all the acknowledged reasons.
Right, good.
Not a lot of hair up here.
Yeah. Not a lot of hair.
I think
she's got the best hair.
They've exhausted that opportunity for you and me.
Yeah, that's true.
They have to try something else in hair on fire. Okay, so. Kevin first, and then Joan. So, and very briefly, because we've got to close pretty soon. What are you going to do next? What's kind of the next challenge that you're going to be facing? And you've done pretty well thus far. You report on some very wonderful instances of progress. The next big challenge for your program is what?
Cost and quality outliers, and then figuring out how. And I think, as we mentioned before we started, this whole SIM process that many states are going through right now has really pushed our Medicaid program and our state employee program and the private payers at the table around adopting common metrics and standards. And it's bumpy, but an important exercise.
Right. Next big challenge. Great. Thanks, Kevin. Joan, what's the big next thing you're going after?
We are working on common metrics in our state because we've always had a lot of them, but the Medicaid program didn't, and with CCOs, they now will. But we are working on, as I mentioned, a mood helper, an online cognitive behavioral program. A lot of anxiety in our population and mild depression that we're trying to get our hands around ways to address that, including things like financial literacy and that, because that's a major stressor for a lot of people. We're also looking at group prenatal. We do already have the centering program, but not as much of it as we'd like. And we have in one of our boards started talking about the use of doulas in our births that are not attended by a midwife, because we know that helps with C-section rate. Reference pricing, flat rate return maternity, or some of the other things specifically we're looking at. And then in some of that Healthy Team, Healthy You kind of program, some of those we have some other options in terms of maternity-focused education kind of thing, or or a series of other programs. So.
Sounds like you've got a few things on the pipeline.
I always have a few things in the pipeline.
Well, thank you, Joan Capwich. Thank you very much, Kevin Limbo. Great ideas here, both sides of the country.
I made it.
So I think you'll see that there was learning across the country, literally, but there are multiple models being tried, fast winners, fast failures, a lot to choose from in a new toolbox. So this is great.